weeks back, I went through all the times and seasons that human beings go through. And I invited you to take a look at the photographs you see on the screen, the two people we've been looking at for 5 weeks now. The person laughing, enjoying life, and the person crying. And I explained to you that that is what life is all about. If anybody thinks you will always laugh from morning till night and from January to December, every day of your life, they are lying to you. Because life is up and down. Life is not always good, and life is not always bad. Every season will come to an end. So no matter what you are going through now that is causing you pain, you know that because it has a beginning, it will have an end. We went through all the seasons, all the times, the time to laugh, the time to cry, the time to be quiet, the time to talk, the time to build, the time to break down, and so on. Today we'll go on to, there's also a time of war, and there's a time of peace. There are times that even as children of God, you declare warfare. There are times that even God himself will say to you, this is the season of war. It is not a time when you begin to preach gentleman's prayer. It is not a time when you begin to keep quiet and say, God, please go and warn them more. And you keep living your life as ordinary. No. There are times of war. That's why it's good for you to study the Bible very well. And you find that even Jesus Christ, whose name is the Prince of Peace, and who told us that pray for your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and so on and so forth. When the time of war came, it was the same Jesus that said, Father, all those who do not want me to reign, bring them before you and slay them. Is that in your Bible? So there is a time of peace and there is a time of war. I'm praying that in your time of war, you will not sleep in Jesus' name.
Amen.
In 1 Samuel chapter 30 verse 8. 1 Samuel chapter 30 verse 8. It was a time of war. The Bible told us of a man called David. He had cried and cried and cried and cried, and he saw that there was no solution. The Bible said after he cried and cried and cried, he lost the power to cry. The Bible said he had no more strength to cry. The man wanted to keep crying, but he had exhausted his ability to cry. He had cried himself out. And the Bible said he then encouraged himself in the Lord. Like many of us, you cry, 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 but you don't go to the next level of encouraging yourself in the Lord. Because sometimes crying will solve no problem. You can cry from now to the end of the world, it will solve no problem. That was exactly what happened to David. He cried and cried and cried, but he lost his voice and he could not cry anymore. But when you continue to read the passage, he said that David encouraged himself in the Lord. And the Lord said unto him, David, you are crying in the day of warfare. This is not the time to cry. This is the time to arise and fight. And when David got the revelation, he said in verse 8, he said, Lord, I have heard you. Shall I pursue? Will I overtake? And how many remember what the Lord said? The Lord said to him 3 things, pursue, you will overtake, you will recover all. That's why I pray for somebody here this morning. As you pursue, you will overtake, you will recover all. Everything that the enemy has stolen from you, you will recover all in the mighty name of Jesus. This is a type of war, and I pray you will not sleep in the mighty name of Jesus. The strength to pursue your destiny. God will give you the strength to pursue your future. And as you pursue, you will regain your destiny in the mighty name of Jesus. As you begin to go through that same story, when you get to verse 17, you will see the man that was crying before. The Bible said now he was a fiery and fearsome man. He had a sword in his hand. He had the bows, he had the dagger, he had everything for warfare. And the Bible said he started to kill from three lines, and he began to kill and slaughter till the evening of the next day. Without stopping, that man that was crying a few minutes ago, God told him, you are crying at the wrong time. This is the time to fight. And he began to slaughter. Let's go to verse 17. Are you seeing what I'm saying? But so that you will know when to stop crying and to start fighting warfare in the spiritual. Verse 17, and David smote them. He did what? He smote them from three lights, even unto the evening of the next day. You can just leave it at that. And that's what every one of us must recognize. There will come the time of warfare. At that point, crying is not the solution. It is arising and fighting with the sword of the Spirit. I'll show you another day of warfare. This one will be reading together. So talk with me to Ecclesiastes chapter 10. Ecclesiastes chapter 10. We read together verse 28 to 29. And then after that, we read three more verses. So just mark those passages in your Bible as a period of warfare. Because whether you like it or not, you too will get to the period of warfare in your land.
Amen.
Exodus chapter 10, verse 28 to 29. And Pharaoh said unto him, get thee from me, take heed to thyself, see my face no more. For in that day that thou seest my face, thou shalt
die.
Are you there? If you are there, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
This was a time when Pharaoh was tired of cursing the Lord. Moses kept on coming to Pharaoh, and he said to Pharaoh, Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, let my people go. Aaron will follow Moses, and the both of them will say to Pharaoh, thus says the Lord. After a while, Pharaoh got tired of thus says the Lord. So look, I'm tired of these things. If you come to my palace again, the day I see your face again, you will die. Is it a time of warfare? What did Moses answer? Verse 29. Let's read it together. And Moses said, thou hast spoken well. I will see thy face again no more. Moses also was tired of thus says the Lord. Moses said, you want to fight? Let us fight. I will see your face no more. You are saying there is a time of peace and there is a time of warfare. This was a time of warfare. Pharaoh drew the line in the sand. The day you show your face again, you are a dead man. And Moses said, you will still be a dead man. So let's read the story going further. That's the chapter, let's go to chapter 12 now, verse 29 to 32. Mark it in your Bible as well. Exodus chapter 12, verse 29 to 32. Exodus 12, 29 to 32. And it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne, unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of cattle. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants, and all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house that was not one dead. Let's stop there for now. Why is he calling Moses? I'm not saying he doesn't want to see Moses anymore. You told this man he shouldn't come and see you anymore, and the man said, okay, I'm not coming anymore. But when he saw the power of God, he said, Moses, please come, I want to see your face again. That's why I want to pray for somebody. Those who have been troubling your life, those who have refused to stop troubling your life, under the anointing of God Almighty, I declare today the last day.
Amen.
If they don't stop today, they will see blood.
Yeah.
If they don't stop today,
Father,
there will be blood all over their family.
Yeah.
If they don't stop today,
Father,
the God that says is the Lion of the tribe of Judah will visit them in the mighty name of Jesus. The story continues. The Bible said he sent for Moses and Aaron by night. He could not even wait till the following morning. And he said to them, rise up, get you forth from my people, both ye and the children of Israel. Go and serve the Lord as ye have said. And also take your flocks and your herds, as ye have said, be gone and bless me. How can the tormentor be asking the tormented to bless? That's how I want to pray for somebody today. All those who have been tormenting you, they are coming back to ask for your prayers. So they will come back to ask for your prayers in the mighty name of Jesus. Several things happened during this battle between Moses and Pharaoh, like we've just read. If you study the passage very well, you will see at least seven things. The first one was that God smote the firstborn of every Egyptian. Think about it. What does firstborn represent? Firstborn represents the next generation.
Come on.
And what God is doing is that not only am I going to destroy your fathers, I will destroy the next generation of tormentors. So that for years to come, my people will have peace. That's why I want to pray for somebody today. Not only will God destroy your tormentors,
amen,
all the next generation of tormentors,
amen,
tonight, amen, they shall be destroyed in Jesus' name. The second thing that happened in that story was that power changed hands. The Bible said there was a great cry in Egypt. How can the Egyptians be crying? The Egyptians are the ones that have been troubling the Israelites. They are the ones that will sit in their house and say to the Israelites, go and build a house for me. Go and do this for me. Go and bring me food. But the Bible said when the battle line was drawn, one side was crying and that side was not on the Moses side, because power has changed hands. That's why I want to pray for you one more time this morning. Today, power will change hands. All the cries that you have cried, all the cries of pain, the Almighty God, the mighty warrior himself, will transfer that cry to your enemies in Jesus' name. All those that have been rejoicing while you were crying, from today, it is their time to cry in Jesus' name. The third thing that happened with this encounter was that there was not a single house where there was no dead man. The Bible said in every house of the Egyptians, there was a dead person. What does it mean? Unmistakable warning sign. But it's possible that if there were some houses that somebody did not die, those folks believe God can't touch them. But God made sure that there was not a single family that did not seek love. That's why I want to pray for you. All your enemies, the ones in Nigeria, the ones in America, the ones in London, the ones that are in Lagos, the ones that are in the village, the ones you can see with your eyes, the ones that you cannot see with your eyes, everyone that is an enemy of your soul, tonight, they will receive a visitor called the Lion of the Tribe of Judah. A visitor called the Great Warrior will be in their house. That was what happened. Point number four, that happened during this encounter. The Bible said, they quickly called Moses and Aaron. What's the meaning of that? It's called the white flag. I surrender. You were the one that declared battle. And now you are the one that has called them to make peace. That's why I want to pray for you again. All those that have been troubling your life, they will call you to settle in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You begin to get phone calls to settle in Jesus' name.
Amen.
All those who have said they don't even want to see you in your house again, they will come to look for you in your house and
Amen.
Beg you. Of your soul, just as Pharaoh surrendered, tonight God will force them to surrender in Jesus' name. The fifth thing that happened during this encounter, Pharaoh opened his mouth and said, please go. These were people that have been in bondage for over 400 years. Their father was a slave. Their grandfather was a slave. Their great-grandfather was a slave. Their great-great-great-grandfather was a slave. Everything they have always known was slavery. That night, Pharaoh said, please go. That's why I want to pray for somebody again this morning. You will receive your freedom.
Yeah.
Everything that has not allowed you to walk in freedom, today the Almighty God will dismantle in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
All those who have seen your star, they know where you are going, and they have paid your star. I decree over your life, even before the end of this service, they will let you go in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
I said they will let you go in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
I said they will let you go in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
You know, the enemy comes in many ways. But we thank God for the grace of God upon our lives. Between last Sunday and now, the enemy has tried me in many ways. During the week, I had an interesting dream. I can't tell you the story. But it's just now that I've been able to understand why they did that. But surely they failed. And because they failed over my life, they will fail over your life in Jesus' name. Point number six that happened during this encounter. Pharaoh and the people said to the Israelites, as you are going, anything that you want, take and go. In other words, look at the whole land of Egypt. Anything that you just fancy, just collect and go. And you can imagine the greediness of 400 years. If you have been starving for 400 years, you know you would like to have everything in one day. That's why the Bible said they spoiled the Egyptians. They collected all their shoes, collected all their wristwatch, collected all their guinea, collected all everything they had. They went from a position of slavery to a position of affluence. That's why I'm praying for somebody today. Today is your turning point.
Yeah.
I say today is your turning point.
Yeah.
Today is your turning point.
Yeah.
Everything you have ever desired in your life that they have not given you, today you receive in the mighty name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Everything that belongs to your family and has not been given unto you, no matter for how long, because you are here today, you will receive your inheritance in Jesus' name. The last thing that happened during this encounter, like you had when we were reading the passage, Pharaoh said to them, before you go, why don't you just pray for me? Before you go, bless me also. What that means is that the people we are going with honor. So for you to bless somebody, the person you are blessing must be down, and you are the one standing and blessing the person. You know, I can almost imagine Pharaoh kneeling down and the slaves, before they bless him, they give him a knock on the head. Did he say you want to be blessed? He said you want to be blessed? Did he say you want to be blessed? But now he's the one that is looking for blessing. That's why I want to pray for you this morning. All those that have been riding on the horse over your life, all those that have acted like big men over your life, they are coming back to beg you in Jesus' name. Yeah. All those that have treated you like slaves, they are coming back to ask for your blessing in the mighty name. Yeah. Let's go to the second battlefront and then we'll wrap up for today. When you read 2 Chronicles, let's read it together and mark it in your Bible as well. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 15 to 17. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 15 to 17. And it said, "Hearken ye, all Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, our dear King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid nor dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow go ye down against them. Behold, they come up by the cliff of Zik, and ye shall find them at the end of the brook, before the wilderness of Jeruel. And ye shall not need to fight in this battle. Set yourselves, stand ye still, and see the salvation of the Lord with you. O Judah and Jerusalem, fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you." Fast forward to about 22, and then we read to 25. Verse 22 to 25. "And when they began to sing and to praise, the Lord set ambushments against the children of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, which were come against Judah, and they were smitten. For the children of Ammon and Moab stood up against the inhabitants of Mount Seir, utterly to slay and destroy them. And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, everyone had to destroy one another." So your enemies are going to destroy one another. Yeah. Before the end of today, they will destroy one another. Verse 24, "And when Judah came toward the watchtower in the wilderness, they looked unto the multitude, and behold, there were dead bodies falling to the earth, and none escaped. And when Jehoshaphat and his people came to take away the spoil of them, they found among them in abundance both riches with the dead bodies, and precious jewels which they were stripped of for themselves, more than they could carry away." I want to also, we're running short of time, but several things happened in this battle as well. Three nations decided it was time to fight against Judah. Judah looked at them and said, "There is no way I can fight this people." So Judah went to God and said, "God, I have have no power against these ones. These ones are bigger than me. I cannot fight them, but my eyes are upon you. The Bible said God responded and said to them, you will not even have to fight. That's why I want to pray for you. The enemies that you can't fight, the Almighty God Himself will do the fighting for you in Jesus' name. I said, God Himself will do the fighting for you in Jesus' name. And God said unto them, all that you have to do is just watch and sing and dance. Is that not a good way to fight? You are just watching, you are singing, you are dancing, and the enemy is dying. That's how I want to pray for somebody. When they come against you, the only thing you will do, you will watch, you will sing, you will dance, and the enemy will be dying in Jesus' name. Of one another. Three of them had agreed to go and fight Judah. On the way, the Bible said two ganged against one. So the two of them, Ammon and Moab, they first destroyed Seir. After they finished killing Seir, then the two people decided, I don't like these people anymore. Then they gathered up against themselves, and the Bible said they also destroyed themselves. Judah did not have to lay a single hand on them. That's why I'm prophesying for you and upon your life. Everyone that have ganged up against you, they will gang up against themselves in Jesus' name. All those that have taken counsel together, that say, let us come and destroy this person before they get to you. God will turn them against one another in Jesus' name. They came to collect. Now please listen to this very well, so that when you are praying on your own, you can pray with wisdom. They saw that Judah was getting blessed by God. Like some people will have noticed that God is now blessing you. Not only is God blessing this church, God is blessing the members of this church. I can see it myself. Even I can testify. And people are already seeing it that you are getting blessed. That's what happened to Judah. So these three nations decided that these people are getting blessed too much. We are going to collect our portion from them. Their determination was to go and collect. But God made sure that instead of collecting, they ended up donating. Even the one they had on them, the Bible said they gave to Judah. I want to pray for somebody this morning. All those who want to collect what belongs unto you, they will end up donating to you in the mighty name of Jesus. All those who have seen the blessings of God upon your life, and they are envious and jealous to come and take what is not theirs. Instead of taking the one that they already have, God will take and add unto you in the mighty name of Jesus. I want you to rise on your feet.